Okay.
Yes, yes, yes.
Hi. I feel like a whole
thing. Are we good? You're good. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you just good. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, yes. I always just have to make sure with my AirPods. Is the music too loud? You know, I'm trying to like give us a little vibe today.
I hear the Chris Brown.
I'm giving us a little 2000s, little 2000s vibe. But thank you so much for joining us for our Work From Anywhere series. For those of you who do not know, my name is Magic. I'm head of community for MilleniVision. So I do everything, events. And the purpose of this Work From Anywhere series is just to kind of tap in with, professionals and kind of see how they've been staying productive, how they're staying sane, throughout these crazy times. You know, we were all just kind of pushed into working from home. A lot of us don't even have work set up. So, it's really just to share some productivity tips, with people who may need them. So today we're going to be sitting with Dominique Patrick, and I'm so excited to have her here. So honestly, we're going to jump right into it. Introduce yourself and let the people know, where you work and what you do.
Okay. So my name is Dominique Patrick, as she already said that. I live in New Jersey. I work for MLB.
Jersey.
Yeah, right. Look, Jersey. People always be bashing Jersey, but I love Jersey.
They do. I'm not going to lie. I'm from the big Bronx, and that's just always what it's going to be. But I've been out here for 4 years now, so I kind of have to start claiming Jersey.
Okay, good. Okay. It's time. But I live in Jersey. I work at MLB Network, which is in Secaucus, which is not far from me at all. I'm huge on commute because, like you talk about sanity, I need my sanity. I don't want to sit morning, make a long commute. But what I do there, my official title is a broadcast associate. I do a lot of editing there. I pitch ideas. I just give a lot of feedback about things that I think will look good. As far as what everything you see on TV, you'll see on MLB Network. I probably had something to do with the editing. So.
Okay. Let's not forget she is an Emmy Award winning. Okay. We gotta drop the Emmy Award winning,
Anywhere we can.
So, and briefly, please tell the people, a little bit about your Emmy Award that you guys won.
Okay, so the Emmy Award was for MLB Tonight. You work, so it's a whole bunch of us, obviously. It's a huge network that was able to put in a certain amount of hours, put long nights, creating a lot of, breakdowns for the talent, putting together a lot of editing and creative ideas. If something big happens in baseball, sometimes we get to pitch ideas and just pretty much put together everything that makes the show what it is besides the audience. So it was a well-deserved Emmy. I think MLB Network definitely deserved that. And us as our producers, we got some credit. We love that. So that's a little bit about, the Emmy that we won. So
yes, well, congratulations again. I know I told you, months ago when it happened, but again, we dropping the Emmy anywhere we can because y'all need to get with her before she blows up. I'm telling y'all.
Stop.
So on top of being a broadcast associate, I also know that you do broadcasting for basketball games. Is that in correlation with MLB?
No, so it's a completely separate thing. So it's basically comes, which I always say is always better than one. Two always better than one.
Hello.
Yes, exactly. So I think a lot of people, including myself, when I went out into the field, I didn't really know how it worked because I'm a basketball analyst for college basketball. And a lot of it is...
Yes, that's what I meant to say. I'm over here talking about broadcasting basketball games. I don't know nothing.
That's fine. I'm an analyst, so it's a lot of it is hands-on, reaching out to those SIDs and sending your email and getting
sorry, back us up. SID, English. We don't know what this stuff means, girl.
So the SID is basically a person who will be over the communications within the college. So I'm sure I run into SIDs. If any journalists have had to reach out to do interviews of athletes, they've run into an SID. The SID handles all of that. They do the hiring. They don't, I think the coach has something to say so as well. Mm-hmm. they handle all of the communication. So, like, when two coaches want to get together and chat, or two journalists want to do an interview with the coach before the game, you would reach out to the SID. And that's also how I got my job. So I worked at LIU Brooklyn last year. I was a broadcast analyst for women's basketball, and I did two men's basketball games. And then this past year, I was at Mahan College, the Bronx. I know. So I would say it's, you know, it's a grind. You know, a lot of people don't really know how to go about securing those jobs, but I think that you just have to send a bunch of emails. I tell people all the time, I send probably like 50 plus emails every year, and I probably hear back from like one or two. You know, sometimes you hear back, sometimes it's a curve, and you know, you just have to kind of, it goes along with, I know every journalist listening to me right now, you got to get used to rejection. Okay, so
And I honestly feel like that's in everything you do, right? And not even just to, you know, sound cliche, but you know, truly, you miss 100% of the shots you don't take, whether that is professionally, personally, you know, if you're trying to shoot your shot to these little boys and these girls out here, you know, if you don't shoot, like, you're not going to know if it's going to go in, you know, unless you actually make the shoot. And I feel like every Monday I get on here, and one thing that I feel like is common with, you know, all of us as professionals is networking, you know, and networking and reaching out and, you know, just continuously reaching out, because it only takes one yes. All you need is one yes.
And be annoying. I tell people all the time,
don't be like, scared.
Don't be very bold in what you want to do. I have a lot of people that try to network with me and get some feedback and things like that. And a lot of them, you know, they're kind of hinting at things or like talking in circles. It's like, hey, just straight up be bold. You know, I'm the type of person, I don't like small talk. So it's now, like,
let's get to it.
Yeah, so when I'm networking with someone, I'm like, hey, you know, how you doing? Blah, blah, blah. Not in a rude way where it's like, hey, what can you do for me? But it's more so of like presenting yourself like, I'm a boss, you're a boss. Let's link up and connect and do some things. Because to give, to get, you're going to have to give as well in this industry. Like a lot of networking has to do like, how is this benefiting me at the end of the day? So I think that if you go into it with that mindset and know that you're going to get told no and be annoying, you know, if that tells you back and be like, hey, you know, we're unsure right now, but I'll keep you in mind. Okay, cool. 10 days later.
Follow up. It's all about the follow up.
I'm cool. Just trying to see if I'm still in mind, you know, because people will remember you for that more so than even your work most of the time. If you just get on their nerves, be like, hey, let me give them a chance. So
no, literally. And that's one thing that I always preach. Like, don't be scared to be annoying. I know you guys see me, you know, hosting these events, you know, moderating and, you know, reaching out to the panelists to actually get on the events is like, you know, I reach out to them and then they don't respond. But it's like, I really want you on this panel. So I'm really about to go in. And I have the funniest story just in regards to that. So earlier last week, towards the end of the week, I'm reaching out to this guy on LinkedIn. We've spoken before, but we haven't spoken in months. So I'm reaching out like, hey, you know, our next panel is coming up. Like, I want you to sit on it. And he's like, not responding. Next day, hey, I'm just following up. Not responding. Next day, hey, I'm just following up. Found a boy on Twitter, followed him. He stayed in private, so I couldn't get to him. So there's this, well, you know, if everything is on the internet, there's this this website where you can put somebody's name in, their location, and find information on them. I used to work in sales, so you know, I have to be a creep. So yeah, I used to get paid to creep on people and find information. So I found a number associated with him. So I'm texting the number like, hey, and I was gonna call, but I say no, let me not be too intrusive. So I'm texting the number like, hey, you know, this is Magic. I'm reaching out. You know, I wrote you on LinkedIn, blah blah blah. Like, is this so and so? And the person goes, no, this is his mother, but I'll send you, I'll send him your number over so that he can get in touch. And I'm like, dang, I didn't even know I was texting the mother. But, you know, I guess sometimes, you know, people, they're all on the same phone plan. So I'm like, listen, I needed to get in contact with this boy. And you know what he did? He wrote me back on LinkedIn. So
you made an impression on his mom.
Exactly. So, you know, I say all of that to say, you know, if you want something, like, don't be afraid to go out there and annoy people, because the worst thing that people can say is no.
Exactly. And then you just move. You move forward. So that's really good advice. That is a really interesting story.
I know. It was super funny. It's like, you know, securing these panelists by any means necessary. But jumping into, you know, before quarantine, with you being a basketball analyst and a broadcast associate, How has the shift been, you know, from working in the office to now having to work remotely at home?
Oh, it's been like a huge shift. I think a lot of people, when they tell me the difference between working from home, is like, obviously they're glad they don't have to make the commute. But
Everyone loves that.
Right. Everyone loves that. For me, it would more so be like, I don't have to put on no real clothes to work. So that's a really
good too. Being the Zoom meetings with a nice shirt and some basketball shorts on. Like.
Exactly. But I think for me, it's just very like, it's different. It's, the adjustment has been different to me. It's more mentally draining because I think I have to over-communicate now as opposed to like, hey, I can just yell across the room in the production setup that we have and say like, hey, I have this or this is ready. It's like now I have to like pick up my phone and send an email or a text and be like, this is ready. So I have to like balance my workload and like figure out how I'm gonna, you know, journalist working with a deadline. So a lot of that has been like a little mentally taxing. And I think like the adjustment for me is more so of like working from home. It's like home is really your peace for most people. And I think like for me, it's like I'm bringing work home. So it's like hard for me to kind of disassociate from the workplace to my house because I'm in my house. So it's like I have to change the scenery. I have to like sit over here this time. I have to move. I have to like make myself refocus because this is the comfort of my home, but I have to pretend like it's a work area. So I think for me, it's just very like, it was playing a little bit on my mental. I was exhausted when I first started doing it. But now I'm getting used to it, maintaining my sanity, making sure I take breaks, and I be doing like a little workout in between. Like
Yes. I be seeing you. But no, literally everything you just said, I feel like is what we have all been experiencing at one point. And I speak about this, you know, my previous interviews, like at one point in May, when I was working from home, I was like super depressed. Cause just like you said, it was hard to kind of find that balance. Like, okay, home is my safe space away from work. You know, when they're irritating me, whenever they're getting on my nerves, whenever I'm stressed out. So it was like the fact that I'm being stressed out and this dead smack, the beginning of quarantine, I really cannot go anywhere. And then I have to stay home. It's like my mind was going crazy. But like you said, it kind of gets to a point where you have to just understand, like, all right, this is the new reality. We're all going through the same thing. Like, I can't sit here and complain. So let me just, you know, just deal with it the best way that I can. And that's obviously when you kind of start, you know, building up new hobbies and finding ways just to keep yourself entertained. And was it kind of the same thing for the basketball analyst job, or did that kind of get put on hold since I know they canceled basketball games at one point, everything was done?
It's a lot of uncertainty. I think it's so interesting because when I wanted to work in the sports field, I would literally say, I will always have a job. I will always have a job. I will always have a job.
And pandemic said, G'd your body.
Yeah. Like, sports not going nowhere, but then it's like, okay, now sports been gone. Like, it's not here right now. So it's still up in the air. You know, I don't really know what's about to happen for this season. It's obviously been really discouraging. I know for me and for other journalists, and when to reach out, who to reach out to, how to stay in the loop, like when people are considering like newer jobs, you know what I'm saying? Like if I want to work with a different college or I want to add another college to what I'm doing right now, it's very hard to like decide like, okay, so do I wait or like, do I go ahead and let them know ahead of time, you know, because no one else is saying anything, you know, it's really hard to like find that balance. It's a lot different. I can imagine that when I do start doing basketball again, it's going to be different. I'm going to be social distancing, sitting away from my partner,
right,
doing interviews. I mean, people have seen the NBA interviews where, you know, they stand behind them or it's like very far from the camera and stuff like that. So I'm pretty sure it's going to take some getting used to as well. But, you know, hey, we're just going to have to take it one day at a time.
Literally. And that is also crazy. We're even seeing at one point, we're in like the basketball games, they had like virtual people. Man. What are they called? Virtual audiences?
Oh,
like,
yeah.
I don't know what I'm talking about. they had like virtual audiences at one point, right?
Yes.
Like this is all seriously so crazy. And speaking of workspace, you know, what does your workspace kind of look like? Like, can we kind of take a look? Can we kind of see?
Yeah, it's very simple. I'm like in the process because I'm like, you're right, this is permanent. You know, we're probably going to be here. But this is my like dining table, like set up here.
Okay.
So it's very, I have my office stuff in the corner. So, but I usually have it on the table and just like office supply, stuff like that. I do a lot of editing. So this is like pretty much where I sit. And then I have my blanket over there because sometimes I get cold. You know, I have to put it over my legs. But I pretty much use my dining table. Sometimes I have a pillow here in case my back starts hurting because you sit in for a long period of times, you know that it's just uncomfortable. So,
oh, 100%. And listen, that is more than what a lot of people can say. You know, my workspace had, so I did have a workspace at one point, but I'm actually no longer working full time anymore. Just like doing MilleniVision 24/7. So I don't necessarily need to sit behind, you know, a desk every day. So my family was like, all right, the table's taking up space downstairs. You're not really working right now. They packed me up. So at this time, at this rate, I'm like working wherever I can, you know, kind of find a good spot. And I actually have this thing. I'll show it to you guys.
Yeah.
This is my bed desk.
Oh, girl.
So I don't know. So I just unfold the bottom and I sit on my bed and I'm just like on my laptop whenever I don't feel like go downstairs. So this has been like super helpful in regards to like my working from home. So for you people that, hello?
I hear you.
Oh, my, one of my AirPods died.
AirPods. So, I'm like, hello,
we're so good. So for people, you know, that don't necessarily have a workspace, I would definitely recommend investing in like a little bed desk. It's super helpful. I invested in that and like one of those back pillow things. This thing, actually, I have it right here in my room.
Drop the link down there too, Justin has dropped
it. And one of these things. So, you know, you pop this bad boy up, lean on it. Also got that from Amazon. I can show you guys. I can send everyone the link if anyone is interested. Wow, yes, twins. Listen, these are super clutch.
Five below.
Oh, mine is from Amazon. Amazon has been getting all of our money during quarantine. Yeah. But no, those are super helpful, you know, when it comes to, you know, just needing a comfortable space. Because if you're just trying to sit up, like, your back will really start to hurt and you just have all types of complications. But so can we kind of know how you got your job at MLB? I know you got the basketball analyst job through like obviously reaching out and, you know, staying connected with people, but how did you kind of wind up at MLB?
So they came to interview at Syracuse University, Newhouse. I don't know if y'all live
here. Newhouse, we talk to we go, but we close enough. We cousins.
Yeah, we cousins. So they came to Syracuse University and they were looking for loggers, I think is what they initially were looking for. But I did some production work while I was at Syracuse University. I took a production class, so I had a reel to actually show them. And so I showed them my reel and they were like, yo, like, this is really good. And, you know, they reached out to me. I think it was like 3 or 4 days later or something like that. And so I interviewed for it. They typically go to Syracuse University. I think a lot, there's a couple of schools where they like travel and they interview. So I interviewed there at my university, which is super convenient because I don't remember if I had a car. I think I had my car up there during the time, but it's like, if you think about like interviewing for a job coming out of college, a lot of people like to get that transportation to like where they want to interview or make that connection, it's a lot harder. So like when places come to the schools, like when there's job fairs and there's stuff like that, then like it's a lot easier for students to find jobs. So that's how I got hired at MLB Network. I don't have a miraculous story about it.
You know, you mentioned that you had a reel to show them, so it sounds like you kind of set yourself up, you know, via like your undergrad years and your graduate years to kind of, you know, get into that position. So for any future journalists that are here that are still in school, you know, and they want to, you know, at some point be an analyst, so, you know, work in the broadcasting industry, like, what tips do you have for people that are currently in college? Like, what should they be doing? Should they be interning? Where should they be interning? Like, what, give them some gems.
I would say for for people who are still in college, like what I just mentioned, make sure you always have a reel. Like, as soon as you get some content.
Excuse me, can you define what a reel is for the people that do not know?
Of course I will. So a reel is basically something you can edit. You can literally edit it on your phone. You don't need Adobe Premiere. You don't need all this high tech stuff. You can edit on your phone. You can, it's just videos of all of the work that you've done. So say you want to produce, have something that you produced in class, a school project, something like that. Just drag it on a timeline, save it on your phone, literally have it and be ready, because in this day and time, especially with like social media, you never know who you're going to be in rooms with. And when they ask you, you know, what do you have? And you're just like, you're unprepared. Like, I'm telling you, like, you will be able to walk in a room with more confidence knowing that you're prepared. Like, Virgo, always over prepared.
Stay ready so you don't have to get ready.
That's it. Exactly. And so, like, that's probably the biggest tip I would give people, is just always have a reel ready. You never know. Like, you may be scrolling, you see a job opportunity, and now it's like, oh my God, I have to do a cover letter, I have to do a reel. No, like, just work ahead. So it could just be like, hey, you're one of the first top people sending in that job, because you never know, that job might close up in 24 hours. So one of the huge tips that I would give for people is, like, it really, when you're over prepared, it really boosts your confidence. Like, when you talk to people,
like, I know I'm gonna be good. Like, I'm ready for anybody that's about to walk in here.
Yeah, you know. So it's easier said than done, obviously, but I think, like, preparedness will have you walking or talking with more authority, because you're just prepared. You know, it doesn't matter if someone says no or not, you'll still have something to pull. Like, you never know, you may run into somebody who's doing exactly what you want to be doing, and they're like, oh, you're a broadcast. I'm like, oh yeah, here's my work, you want me to send it to you, I'll text it to you, like, whatever you do, stuff like that. So that's one of the tips I have. Another huge one I would say is just research thoroughly what type of job that you want to do when you graduate. Make sure that you're ready to put in the time and the work that has to go, because I feel like I got a really good education at Syracuse, but I feel like as far as the real life nitty gritty down to it, I was a little unprepared. I feel like got really good education, and they told us like price range and all of these things, but like to be prepared to work in media and be like, oh, I may be freelance for years, or I may have to like check coming from here or get another check coming from here, you know. So I think it's just really research and reach out to people who are doing exactly what you want to be doing, and so they can just keep it real with you, you know. So I that's something that I don't think I did much of, so I would just give that tip out to you guys.
Sir, it's very interesting that you say that, because I feel like all of us, you know, as recent college graduates, you know, we kind of feel the same way. Like, you know, we got a good education, we learned a lot, but it doesn't, we don't necessarily feel fully prepared, you know, to enter the world, you know, and take on these roles. And I feel like that's why I'm very big on a lot of stuff is really not what you know, it's who you know. And that's another reason why I emphasize networking so much, and like just building, you know, positive relationships. Just because you're networking someone, it doesn't necessarily mean they're gonna, you know, provide you with a job the next day or a job even at all, but you never know, 6 months down the line, like, people remember, you know, valuable conversations, and it's like, oh, I met Dom 6 months ago at a Forbes event, or I met Magic last year at a Google event. I remember she said X, Y, and Z, so let me hit her up on Instagram or LinkedIn, you know, wherever we connected, and see, you know, if she's working, if she's found a job, you know, if I could get her in wherever I can. And speaking of LinkedIn, I know, you know, the broadcasting industry is obviously different from, like, you know, like the business world and stuff like that. So would you recommend like LinkedIn being a good place for people to network, or should you be more like Googling people and like trying to send out emails? Like,
so I'm iffy about it. I have a lot of connections on LinkedIn, but I don't think through LinkedIn I've really gotten like these huge opportunities. I have people who say, like, I have a recruiter reaching out to me and stuff like that. I think for sports, like, media, like, I haven't heard of anyone really being super successful linking with someone on LinkedIn. I mean, yes, you can send someone a message. I've done that a couple times, but it's fallen through, or it's just like, hey, I don't know you. You know what I'm saying? I feel like Instagram and Twitter is a lot more intimate than seeing their business profile. Like, who's really checking their LinkedIn every day, all day? So you may get a response a month later, you know. Instagram was hey, I see what she's about. I see what she's doing on a day-to-day basis. She looks cool. I could hit her up. I could send her because everybody be checking their Instagram. So it's like,
for sure.
Yeah. So I think LinkedIn is beneficial. I've had a couple people reach out to me, and I try to be good on getting back to people, but everyone is not like that. Or like, this right. is like downtime for me as well. Like when things go back to normal, or if there is ever a normal, a lot of people be ripping and running.
Right. So,
but I think LinkedIn is a beneficial tool, but for me personally, I haven't used it. The only thing that I've used it for is like applying to jobs. But then you have the job with the spam, and they want you to sign up through all of this different stuff. So,
right.
Oh, it's just, it's a hit or miss, I guess, for me.
That's very interesting, because as someone that's more, I guess, in like the corporate-y, like marketing business kind of sector, I'm like, LinkedIn all day, you know, like gotta constantly stay on people on LinkedIn. But I was actually just speaking about this with a friend not too long ago, and he was basically saying the same thing, that he doesn't necessarily really use LinkedIn that much. Mm-hmm. And I was telling him, you know, I really feel like it depends on the industry, because I feel like certain industries may not use, you know, that tool as much. So I think that's very interesting that, you know, you kind of say you don't really use it, but more so like Instagram and Twitter is like kind of a more personable way. So for anyone watching this that is interested in the broadcasting industry, obviously still reach out through LinkedIn, because it's literally a networking, you know, social media platform. But also, you know, maybe switch it up, you know, get a little more personal and find these people on these social media sites. And, you know, maybe you never know what can come from it.
I would say about LinkedIn is they have like the little edit thing. So if you build your profile and put, you can put your reels on there. I have my reels on there. So if you put all of your reels.
I'll add you after this.
it can act as a website, because I know a lot of people want like this website that shows all of their work and has everything in one place. So like, if you don't want to buy a domain for a website, which some of them are free, if you don't want to do that, you can do LinkedIn. You can have your resume, you can upload everything. So when people are asking for, hey, do you have a website or anything, be like, hey, here's my LinkedIn, everything is in one place. So that's one thing I will say, it can act, because you can share the link to your LinkedIn, so it could be helpful.
Oh, okay. Well, that is super clutch. I'm going to open the floor up for anyone watching. If you guys have any questions for Dom, please feel free to submit them. And before we wrap up with questions, I do kind of want you just to share, like, what are some skills that you feel like people kind of need to, you know, excel in this industry? For people that are either in college looking to graduate and hopefully secure a full-time job, or people that have graduated and are struggling, you know, looking for a job, or even people that are trying to transition into the industry, what are some key skills you think are necessary?
I think necessary skills that you need to have to work in this industry would probably be, I would say you have to know how to adjust, like on a small scale, on a large scale, meeting a deadline, something falls through, you got to pull something out of your head, like, look, you got to learn how to adjust, like, you know, this media, working in media and being an honor person, you're going to end up in different cities. You're going to end up in different places talking to people that you don't know, whatever. So it's like, I know a lot of people have different backgrounds, and a lot of times they don't really have to go out of their way to get the things that they want. Oh, you want to be a job? You have to get over that. You're going to have to get over hey, I think I'm being annoying, or I don't want to ask this person, or I don't want to reach out, or like, I don't really want to thrive in this quote unquote city. Like, sometimes you're just gonna have to do it. So I think like a skill that you really have to have, and like, even when you're on air, you have to adjust, you know, like, I remember I was editing something for It Will Be Tonight, and I'm putting in all these hours in his work, and you know, someone died, someone, you know, it was like the Tom Seaver's death, which is very well known. He dies and it kills everything. So now you have to adjust, you know what I'm saying? Or if I'm on
pivot
ball game and this girl breaks a record, everything else goes out the window. You know what I'm saying? It's all about that record that she broke. So you just have to adjust. You know, it's one thing about being an analyst on air, you're talking the whole time. So you just have to adjust to what's happening during the game. Everybody doesn't want to do that. But I think as a journalist, because I have friends that work in news as well, like, you just have to, you're doing a live shot and somebody comes behind you and they're making jokes and harassing you and doing all this stuff, and you just have to adjust. So I think that's a necessary skill that you really have to have, that's going into this field, for sure.
I know, I think I think that makes like a lot of sense, perfect sense. Like you see, you know, when certain things are happening, like in, was it the news industry? Is that even a thing? I guess it's all broadcasting.
You're right.
I don't know why I tried to switch it up like that. But anyway, you know, like what I'm trying to say is like, you know, when you see people like on the news and stuff, it's like they obviously have the planned things they want to talk about. But like you said, when someone dies or someone gets shot or something like major happens, it's kind of like you just got to automatically scratch whatever you know, were planning to say. And now you kind of have to focus your attention on that. So, you know, I think that makes perfect sense. Yeah. It seems like many people don't really have any questions for you, but this was like super, super, you know, amazing and informative. I think if anyone is interested in like journalism or broadcasting, like I think watching this interview is definitely going to provide them with, you know, more knowledge and kind of set them up to, you know, be better to excel in the field. So Dom, thank you so much for sitting with me. You know, you could have been anywhere on a Monday at 7 o'clock, but you was here with me and MilleniVision, and we appreciate you. You know, hopefully we will see you again soon.
Yes, thank you for having me so much. And I don't know how to figure out how to save this. This is really good. This is really exciting.
Yes, I'm gonna save it and it'll be posted to our page. You can always go back for review.
Thank you so much. And a great job to you, man. You did a good interview, girl.
Thank you. You know, I'll be trying a little something, you know. I gotta get better at when I first enter the live, I feel like the camera kind of be like, in my forehead, because I be trying to pin the comment, so I gotta get better at that. But stay tuned.
It's hard to see. I can't even read like what's down there. So no.
I know. We'll figure it out. But have a good night, and thank you again so much.
You too. Thank you so much for
having me.
Bye.